Welcome back, everyone, to the Insomnia True Server Championship. Now, that was quite a video.
Power glow.
Yeah, I don't know what happened.
Power overwhelming.
Oh, goodness.
It was 16 bits, man. Hey, wait, it was 8 bits, actually.
8 bit video. Yeah,
yeah. 8 bits, sorry.
Old school.
That's one question, though. If you have a power glove and you want to devour all the games, why do you go to the underground instead of being in the middle of the city devouring all the games?
Because that's just how it works, Nimsh. I don't like your closed-mindedness. Thank you. That being said, we're onwards to the fourth match of the day. We've got the next one, opposing players that we don't really know too much about. It's Slytha, which we saw qualify through the international online qualifier. Mm-hmm. And his opponent, Riri, is a local. You know, we were mentioned that the Riri and Ness are both locals.
Yeah.
So
we don't know much about them.
Right.
This is their chance to present themselves to the community and to us as casters. I know a bit about Slytha. I was talking to him and I could wonder if they feel like they're the only players from Spain. I don't know what Pini Awesome has to say about that. But
Isn't Pini from Portugal? No, wait, he's from Spain,
Spain, yeah.
Yeah. Oh, that's an insult I just said.
What have you done?
Yeah, what I have done.
Somebody's mad out there.
Pini is attacking you.
Yeah, for sure, man. But they're both playing paladins, they're both playing druids, and the difference is in the third class, which is the warrior and the warlock.
I mean, I don't know what type of warlock that's being played, because that's what basically makes the big difference in the way things are going to work out.
Yeah.
There's about, 17,000 lists right now that people are running, so it's really hard to make a call.
And most of them are running Dark Peddler.
Right, they're all running that, right?
All right, but the first game we are going to see is Paladin versus Paladin.
Paladin versus Paladin, they're both playing secrets, at least there's a Venge. So we can make an assumption that there's a mysterious challenger.
In both decks.
Hmm.
But that's a pretty rough curve for Riri. If it starts with Repentance, it's gonna be a little bit rough.
Especially the fact that the Repentance is not usable on turn one.
You could try if you had Muster, I guess, but...
All right, so Paladin versus Paladin is an interesting matchup because it's not that much about who's going to win on board, but it's like who is going to be first. Like the one without the coin, the player who's playing first and is playing on curve, is eventually going to win. But it seems like Riri didn't have anything on the one.
Yeah, but it's fine, I think, because he got the Noble Sacrifice off the top, which let him protect himself. And now if Slytha wants to protect his Secret Keeper, his only option is to go for Coin Muster, attack with a weapon. But that means the mini-bot stays alive and can then wreak havoc on the board, or to play Repentance to increase its health. Mm. Is there ever an argument to just hero powering? Like, is that ever a thing you would do?
No, I think it's either to play Muster Battle or play Repentance into hero power.
Or just Knife Juggler, just to play mind games. Because if you play Knife Juggler into this situation,
it's a waste.
Is it?
Yeah. So it might be important to keep the coin for Mysterious Challenger. But on the other hand, if you're able to take the board this early, it actually gives you an advantage. All right. So there is a shield and mini bot from Riri. Repentance probably doesn't do much at this point.
So, the Repentance wasn't played, he has gone for the Masterful Battle.
Yeah, Shield Mini Bot makes this.
It's kind of funny how they're both stuck with the Repentance early game, and they probably think, I'm the only one stuck with Repentance early game.
Yeah. It often happens, like, sometimes players just have bad hands, like both of them.
Those are the interesting games.
The druids that both draw horribly
and
actually trade.
Oh man, 3 mana doesn't seem good. Probably juggler and nothing else.
I mean...
Well, the Repentance will be played, I'm sure of that.
If he spots the Repentance here, he's going to be, oh, it's not Redemption, so I'm good, I can make trades now. Which is something he wasn't going to do, and he was trying to set up a Consecration by popping their shield.
Mm-hmm.
But now he might reevaluate.
Well, on turn 4, what do you expect? You expect maybe Keeper, you expect Shredder. So does it matter that much if you actually hit this with Repentance?
And now the question is, if there's a Consecration on your board, Is it a problem?
Oh, my.
Oh, look at that.
I mean, it's not that much of an issue, right? Because you are playing your own Consecration afterwards. It's taking up his entire
turn. But that wasn't the
plan.
He has
the initiative.
He,
right.
played the Repentance just to have a better Consecration on his own, right? So maybe it was actually a merit to trade with one of the mini-bots for your opponent to play into your Consecration. But it's a tough call.
I think the Tutor Champion is an amazing draw here, because if he goes for Consecration here, then he's letting himself, you know, he's free of Blessing of Kings. He's not going to necessarily run into that problem. And then on 5, whatever the other Paladin plays, True Server should be able to handle it at least enough.
The problem is you don't have the turn 5 play. Like, even if you go to Server, if you would
it
not play Consecration.
It is sort of a turn 5, but
yeah,
not
yeah,
really.
Yeah.
Well, at least the Repentance will allow Slifa to kill it with the Light's Justice. So
now you don't play the Shusover, or do you still?
Well, you just don't waste one of the durability points, and that's it.
Yeah, you're right.
I might play True Silver, but I don't, just for the health gain, but you're going to get that, and I don't think that the game will be ending nearly, you know, before you've expended those two charges anyway.
Oh, that's a Curator.
That's difficult. All right, he does go for the Hero Power here. Wants to have a trigger, perhaps, for the Mysterious Challenger or alongside it.
I don't like that at all.
But
I don't like that at all, because you will not play the Truth of a Champion most likely on turn 7 anyway, because you need minions on board. And gaining the tempo right now with the Truth of a Champion would have been very important.
Yeah, Trusova would be amazing just to deal with the Juggler this turn.
Yeah, I'm just surprised he opted not to. Now, guaranteed to get all the secrets left in his deck, but that doesn't mean he's necessarily in a winning position, depending on what Riri finds here.
He's very low when it comes to health points, and that's something really scary, even if you're facing a Paladin.
And he's not even threatening the health of his opponent. So even though this Mystery Challenger will have plus 4 attack, 3 from Avenge, and plus 1 from Competitive Spirit, it doesn't matter that much, because you still have to trade into those 3 attack minions.
Yep. And he has no way of making it a taunted minion, so has to be used as a trade material, which is awful for him.
And he probably die into turns anyway.
I don't think there's a turn. I was gonna say, I don't think there's a way for Slitha to live, unless he's playing a weird list.
With
Defend of Argus is the type of weird list that usually will get you out of the situation, because you play Defender with a Juggler and then you have a pretty, you know, buffed up board. But as it stands,
Slayer boys.
Like a Hail Mary on the Shredder looks like the only out. Another
what?
Barber.
What are the odds? The Barbers.
How many 2-drops are now?
He's shaving that Paladin pretty clean.
Absolutely, right?
And that's going to be game right there. Slitha will go down. It is the most important game of the match. We were talking about that earlier when we cast last match. Paladins are usually the go-to opener for all players who bring the class, and whoever wins with it not only gets the first win, but they have a deck that's good against the entire field.
Yeah.
And because of that, they're able to sometimes just, you know, get 2 wins right off the bat, sometimes even 3.
Especially because Paladin can get, not only is good versus entire field, it also has sometimes unconditional wins when you curve out perfectly and your opponent can't do anything. So we're going to see Paladin from Riri again because it survived, and Slitha has to change deck. He goes with Armorsmith.
Looks like a patron. The Battle Rage here, usually a pretty big giveaway.
Yeah. Usually a really big giveaway when it comes to the Patron deck, because that's the only warrior deck that currently runs this card. But I don't know, my impression of current performances when it comes to Patron is like, I would rather play something else.
I agree with you.
Right?
I like it.
I mean,
I feel like it doesn't, like what people report as results is not at all what I see.
Yeah.
That's probably because people didn't play at least Star Seeker, but now everything changed.
You're right. Kranich is redefining.
Yeah, Kranich
the
was
meaning
saying it in
of Patron.
It was so important.
Yeah.
I'm sure when we will see Kranich, if we will see Kranich again with his Patron of Star Seeker, he will use the Star Seeker, and the Star Seeker will be a second last card in the deck. And even if you will get it, it will not matter.
It's the new Grom.
Are you doubting Kranich? Do you think Kranich is going to die off stage, like silently?
I don't know, man. I don't know.
This is a pretty good opening for both players, I'd say.
Yeah, I feel like the turn 3 from Riri might be where things start to get a little weird if there's a War Axe, and there is one. And there's also the Dread Corsair, which slows down Riva's ability to keep pushing. So Slitza here with a really good turn three is likely to be in control of the game for a little while longer.
Yeah.
Wow, the bear trap without the activation for one mana.
That's actually a good way to put it. I like that.
No, it's awful, but it's
Yeah, Iron Fur Grizzly is the best.
Yeah, well, that's not a beast, that's a pirate, right?
Which is and there's
more synergy with the beasts than with the pirates.
What can he get for the turn three? Lothab is not, so you just do that.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. If Slitha is actually able to stop the turn three from Riri, after that point, he's able to start whittling down.
One thing that I didn't like is the fact that Riri did the hero power so quick. I wanted him to like bluff.
Yeah, yeah.
Maybe I'll have something else, but I don't want to play it. Maybe I have Masterful Battle.
But it's not worth it here. Yes, there's no reason
exactly.
to play it into one.
But when he played it so fast, your opponent knows, okay, now he has only 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 drops.
And I'm dead. Yeah. Mine
Might
was
a
good
problem.
Life, but there's no more.
This is such a great situation for Sifa. Unstable Bull here on empty board. It can get killed with True Server, but if it doesn't, if there is a minion, and you hope there is something like Father Shredder.
So I really hope that Riri will not pick up a Path to Shredder right now. Because then he would go for the Path to Shredder when he needs to kill that ghoul instantly right now.
Right. Yeah, and you can't let that be before turn 5. If turn 5 hits, it's his death bite all over again.
Double patron. But you still go with the Lothab here.
Like patron in a rage.
You like patron in a rage?
I think, well, I mean, I guess you need maybe to wait for another whirlwind effect. Lothab is safe, you're right.
Like, patron in a rage is too dangerous. If there is consecration, you just throw them. Or, like, even if there is a minion.
Wow. Yeah. Can't play repentance now
even
for the patron.
Tag.
Look at that.
3-3.
The repentance is not allowed to counter the patron.
You can't.
There's not enough mana.
Well, it's not like there is a whirlwind, so it's still just patron in a rage.
Yeah, but patron with 1 HP and great deal.
It's a bit better. Just face the patron without anything else.
Hmm.
That's a solitary patron.
Face the pate.
Nobody get in here. I'm just drinking alone.
Nobody get in here. I'm drowning my sorrows. My best friend got nerfed and now she's worse than a raid leader.
Such a sweet song.
Yeah. Pretty sad.
But do you still play it? You can't, right? Like, this is so bad.
Everything is bad. There's no way out of this.
I'm gonna pass.
I'm gonna break the news to you, Nimsh. This turn is bad.
There has to be something, Noxious.
This is the problem of the decks that are just pulling it off as a combo, right?
What if
just have those turns?
What if Slitha? I mean, what if Patron only had one Patron, the way all Rogue is cutting to one oil?
One page.
Okay, then so why would you play Unstable Ghouls and Whirlwinds and
Right, that's what I'm saying.
Well, he has an okay turn now because he can patron Inner Rage and Battle Rage.
I love that.
You know what you can do? You
play
can
another
cut
deck.
One patron, then you can cut Inner Rages, Battle Rages, Whirlwinds,
make control warrior,
Unstable Ghouls, and add midrange mid creatures.
Like right. Cochrane Elites, put Finley Murgleton to be able to ping. Your
to go face. No, you need to go face. You need to pay the warrior hero power, play heroic strikes. And play it like a real warrior. But yeah, I feel like Patron is in a weird spot because this turn exactly is kind of what we were talking about. We don't see the deck perform nearly as well as we hear it should. And even though it is considered a top tier deck by a lot of players, and then we're talking about some of the best players, it is really odd when you see it perform in tournament
well,
settings.
It might be metagame reliant, and Paladin actually knows how to play versus this specific Patron right now. So I've seen Paladin win more. There is Mystery's Challenger.
Yeah.
So easy turn.
Yeah, how can
well, you have
not?
To play
it's so ridiculous.
Wait, why didn't he play the Repentance last turn? Oh, he played the Hero Power instead of Repentance. That was really weird.
It's
I don't know.
Fine. He can play Repentance now. And if he do it, does it like super fast, it will look like he played Mystery's Challenger for 7 months. Like Lothar
right.
did it once.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
It's like,
oh. Scientist, right?
Yeah.
Well, when I was playing against Lifecoat, actually. Lifecoat was confused.
Super confused. So basically, Lothar had Mad Scientist, no secrets in the deck, and he lost his Mad Scientist, and he played Mirror Image, from his
and
hand.
And it looked like he got two? Or he, like,
no,
it cost
no,
him
no,
five more.
I just played it, like, my IPM was over the top, right? And I just queued up the trade with the Mad Scientist, and I instantly played the secret from my hand. So Lifecourse, like, what he saw was the fact that the
Mad Scientist got a secret.
Got the secret, but then I lost three mana, and he was like, what the hell?
Did he play it, or did he get
you know,
it?
You know his face, right?
Yeah.
Whoa, what happened here? Did I miss something? And then he Alt F4 reboots. He's like, no, there's no glitch.
Guys, this is production value. Look at those five beautiful secrets.
It is. Those are really Christmas lights. If there ever was
one should be green,
ballad.
One should be red, one should be purple.
Happy Feast of Winter's Veil.
One should be
orange.
Happy Feast of Winter.
Orange, green sheep, blackout, purple. Now we're missing one.
We need
blue,
green sheep,
blue
right?
player.
Yeah.
Did you say green sheep?
Green sheep, yeah. Okay. Green sheep is the green. We're looking for a blue player, though.
We have white. Or we had white. Because Powder's nickname was White Powder, but he had to
change. That was a really bad nickname.
That was a bad
nickname. That is a very bad nickname. Who won? White Powder. Yeah, that's why I didn't go to school.
I would cast that.
I'm sure you would. All right.
Oh, wow, the Goldhammer. But Turin is probably better.
Yeah.
I mean, it's hard to misplay if you're Riri in that spot. You'd have to try to not win to lose.
Are you ever afraid of Brawl?
No. Against Patron nowadays, it's unfortunate, but there was a very small window
where they played it.
And I think it had to do... it was actually during the...
The end of the Warzone Commander.
Exactly. The end of the Warzone Commander when Secret Paladin was starting to make its way.
Yeah.
And Brawl started coming up.
Could you basically play Brawl to counter Patron?
Oh, wow. That actually was a huge mistake.
Well, a huge one. It's a mistake.
No, it's a huge mistake because he lost a minion. He lost the Murloc. That was a 4-3 because of that trade. He did trade first.
He didn't need to lose the 4-3 at all.
Yes,
he
at all.
He threw it away into the front.
Exactly.
Well, Beacon Hunter, is interesting. But then there is redemption, right?
I mean, you can draw with the Acolyte. If there's a Noble Sack, you're going to draw two cards from it all
the
time.
You're right.
If you pick up a Whirlwind here and you get, let's say, an Execute,
If there is like a Venge hitting Turian, you can deal with Turian. That doesn't matter.
And I just want to go back to the turn when which Rui was playing. I really don't understand his train of thought to leave the Acolyte on board when he clearly had the Noble Sacrifice with the Avenge and Redemption, right? So wasn't it just better to clear out the board and sacrifice the damage?
Maybe he forgot he has Noble Sacrifice.
I think he forgot, but in this case, it's actually really punishing because the Inner Rage can take out one of the boring... the redemption story was triggered on the 2-1.
Yeah.
And by using the BGH, you can guarantee a clear over a few turns.
Okay, this is something I didn't understand either, because...
I'm curious now why he did this.
Why won't you kill the Tyrion? I know that it adds 5 damage to the board with the weapon, right?
But it takes
It actually deals at least 9 damage.
And you lose the shield as well. Okay, I'm actually confused.
I said 9 because it's 8 HP plus 1 for the Divine Shield, right? But when you have to sacrifice a full attack...
I think he doesn't want to give his opponent the weapon. That's the reasoning. The thing is, I'm trying to figure out how threatening that weapon really is.
I mean, he's at 25 HP. It's not that horrible, right?
Maybe he thought that Big Hunter only targets minions with 7 attack. And Tyrion had 9.
Now you're being way too logical about this, Nimsh.
Well, he is in a bad spot anyway, especially after Consecration.
He would have been in an okay spot, because maybe you can execute that 7-7 afterwards, right? But now the Tyrion is basically unanswerable.
Yeah, what can you do with the Tyrion? You can just Inner Rage that into Whirlwind into Execute.
Well, I mean, Patron, Inner Rage, Battle Rage will eat up right now 7 of your mana. You'll be drawing 2 cards. There's got to be some kind of God draw happening. It has to be a Whirlwind.
We second Bigger Hunter.
It's not a Whirlwind, and neither is this, and that should be end for Slitha in this game.
Oh wow, what a fair play. He didn't concede. Look at that.
It's actually okay. I like players who allow me to finish the game.
Nimsh likes it when he's able to get the lethal blow, right?
So like, in card games, in traditional card games, what you did was like showing your opponent the hand. It's like, okay, I got you with those cards. Those were my decisions. So I like when the opponent actually like shows all the stuff, so like plays all the cards he had in the hand and then finishes me off.
To see what misplay did you, like what did you play around that you did not have to play around?
Yeah, exactly.
Based on what I've been doing.
Instead of just winning, right? And
right.
If I concede, I don't have that information.
I would like to be able to say reveal hand, like tick an option that says reveal my hand at the end of a game.
Yeah, exactly.
Just for the sake of, you know, sportsmanship. If you want to have a communication system between players that is not toxic, that's got to be one of the best ones.
It's like I had pocket aces.
Yeah, like I didn't top deck the Savage Roar. I had another one, let's say. So.
But then it would be like, well, he didn't have anything and he top decked. Of course.
Exactly. That's exactly how it feels.
And then you just slam, Happy Feast of Winter's Vale. Yeah.
And then all the trees come out. They should have Christmas hats as they punch you in the face. Little Santa's little helpers.
We should have Christmas cards as well. Like Thorison with the Christmas hat.
I agree with that.
Leper Gnome being the leper helper.
Helper Gnome?
Of Satan Claus, right?
Sidon Klaus.
Who's going to be the reindeer? Like Rudolph.
Well, we had a reindeer in World of Warcraft TCG.
We had Metzen.
Metzen.
It was like Chris Metzen. Metzen the reindeer.
Yeah, it was actually pretty funny. They had a lot of cool cards in that TCG. We have a lot of, honestly, I feel like in the game that we have in Hearthstone, we have a lot more whimsical cards, but we don't have any of the crazy, like Leroy Jenkins. You know, you have to stand up and scream Leroy Jenkins to get
charged. Otherwise,
charge.
You can attack with it. Yeah.
There's so many cool cards in that game.
Like Fellriver, you had to actually stomp with your feet, right? To actually play it.
I like there was a huge wolf, and you had to howl to actually like get the tokens. So like randomly,
beautiful.
When there was like 400 people playing, you just heard randomly like people howling in the different parts of the room.
Oh no! Oh, if they ever put in voice communication in Hearthstone, that's the first thing they have to add. But they never will. Never.
Yeah. Well, for now we have a happy feast of winter.
So you know, we didn't really talk about the game at all since it started, which just goes to show how engrossed we are in that old conversation about the WoW TCG. But the start from Riri was really. Like, it seems like it's powerful because he's on curve, but overall it's kind of weak.
Yeah,
the minions are not that great.
Right, exactly. There's no mini bots, no jugglers, no pressure.
He's missing turn four as well. And that's a really good pickup, actually. There is a silence, but for him, from his perspective, it's a four drop, and it's a card that he can cast right now to create pressure and board.
And he just saw a keeper, so he doesn't expect a second one for sure.
He's so happy and so devastated when he sees the second keeper.
I mean, even if there will be a no keeper on board, not now, you can't not play it. The problem is I was thinking about trading with the Keeper of the Grove, you know?
To make sure that there's no possible, you know, attack here, then set up a swipe over a few turns, let's say.
Yeah, I just don't like giving my opponent the option to have creature on board when I can still be in charge even if he will silence, right? Because that trade was really good.
Yeah, it was a good trade to have. Now, however, if Slither opts for the Drake, that means Riri gets the full value from Divine Favor.
Yeah, that Divine Favor is going to be brutal.
Yes, it will. Goodness, this is insane.
Do you even play the secret? Oh, yes, you do. You can get another
seven cards for free mana.
A pretty good deal, but a bit better than the Battle Rage.
A bit.
He gets double avenge. Just
and
to
he
start.
Can still play one secret.
Well, his Challenger suddenly looks pretty bad, though.
What do you care?
It's not that terrible.
It is a seven drop.
And avenge is still pretty good.
Because you can play it on seven with another secret, so you're fleshing out whatever it gives you. Like you're filling up the avenge that it doesn't give.
But he will have seven mana, so you'll be able to, again, like do the Lothar shenanigans.
Yeah, of course.
I don't think he'll be fast enough. Forbidden APM techniques are forbidden for a reason, Nimsh.
He can try.
I mean, even if the Mysterious Challenger will give him like two secrets, still worth it.
Yeah. It's still 6-6 that draws two cards. It looks like that swipe was pretty good.
Yeah, and he actually knew it's not redemption somehow. He hoped it's not redemption. So he took the gamble and it worked out.
But the game would look so different if only he would made the trade with the Keeper. He would still have the Haunted Creeper on board and kill the opponent.
Yeah, that's right. It would have made a bit of a difference in this exact spot. Now, Riri doesn't really have 1,000 options, right? He has Noble Sack in hand that he can play with the Challenger if he wants, or he's got the Avenge that he can play with that.
I think you should go for the mass minions.
I don't like a Challenger here. I think
I don't like the Challenger.
Isolating
either.
It makes it too vulnerable to BGH.
Actually,
in this exact case.
It doesn't make it that vulnerable to BGH, because is there a Noble Sacrifice being played at all? Okay, we actually got the Noble Sacrifice because he got it from Challenger.
Yes. I was thinking that playing Knife Juggler, Minibot, Noble Sacrifice just makes a more durable
persistent
board.
Yeah, persistent, yeah. Or durable, yeah.
Just not so weak to mass removal. And
I feel like Slith is just trying to set up his combo kill next turn, right? You go Shade, Shredder. I think at this point, based on what he's doing now, he's trying to set something up. Because he's hovering over the Shade.
Shade and Shredder makes a lot of sense. Like, next turn he'll have Savagery and Force Nature. He has that Innervate.
Yeah. Doctor Boom's good as well, but Repentance.
Well, he's not sure if there's Repentance, right? That's
well, now he knows.
It's really possible.
Because it can't be Noble Sack.
Yeah, so there was no Noble Sack.
No, there's none. He played the first one early in the game.
That's one. It's pretty
turn
good.
One, right?
Because there's no way this is going to get a BGH. Like, there's no way to get a Vengeful.
Well, now he's giving him a Consecration. He's giving him a Consecration in order to give him Boombot to the face damage, in order to give him the combo to the face to win. That's a pretty nice gift.
There's no Consecration, though.
Well, yeah. He would have given him one.
Well, there's still Knife Juggler.
Knife Juggler and a couple of minions. Yeah, it's not terrible.
He dies at the first knife.
The bomb.
I'm calling it. Dibs on Knife Juggler's life.
I would say second knife.
Second knife?
Yeah, second knife is going to kill the bomb and juggler. Lothar, which knife? First one.
Oh.
Almost. maybe you're right, Nimsh.
The second knife.
Oh, second.
Well played.
There is one more knife, guys.
Yeah, but nobody wins.
You know. But why wouldn't go for the Noble Sacrifice then? Interesting. I mean, he's dead anyway, but why not Noble Sacrifice?
Is he dead for sure?
Yeah, 100%. Like, yeah. Over 100.
Right.
And Slitha does set up the lethal over two turns that he gets in the end. I mean, Shade and the Shredder kind of worked out as one of the plays, but you could play the Dr. Boom. If you think you don't need the Shade necessarily to live, it's still weak to Consec, so maybe there's a good argument to do that. Either way, having minions on the board is what he needed, making sure that something was there to give him a tiny bit more reach with the combo play.
And look what made the difference, the one additional keeper.
Early in the game.
Yeah. That was the mistake that changed the pace of the game and didn't allow Ri to just have always the board control. And I think that's...
There's a lot of tiny turns that like change the dynamic of the game, and I think usually it's hard to kind of spot them. A few times, though, you can really see where it happens, and I think that trade was one of those stages where you end up with a minion on the board that has too much health for you to remove effectively.
On the other hand, there was the Innervate, so you hope there is no combo on turn 8.
Yeah. Yeah, you couldn't predict the Innervate combo. Even though the hand is big, sometimes they don't necessarily hold everything. And we see a Zoo,
yeah.
I think, from Riri, which gives him a really big edge.
A really great matchup
deck
for Riri. Zoo versus Druid.
Yeah, and the start from Slitha does not involve any ramp.
No Wilder Growth, no Innervate.
He will get an Innervate, man. He will get an Innervate with the next draw. Just count on that.
You want to see the world burn, Lothar.
But it's still not that great. Because there's no minion just to kill it with the Keeper of the Grove, right?
Shape shift. You probably don't rough it, just shape.
Why not?
Because if you get something bigger next turn, you want to rough that one.
Like, if you would have a Flame Imp in hand, that would have been played. So there's no Flame Imp. And you're not doing anything on turn 3 either. So what do you?
You rough
shape shift again?
You rough on 3?
Well, now you can make a raft because there's no difference if we made it on turn 2 or on turn 3.
I guess the only difference is if you wanted to innervate on 3, assuming you top decked something, then you really had to wrath on 2 to get rid of that minion. But it's like it's a minor difference in the way it pans out. This is interesting because he's setting both Voidwalkers at 2.
So the keeper can clear it up, but the problem is
with Defender,
that
it's going to be...
Yeah. The Defender of Argus makes here a huge difference.
Especially if he damaged the Void Walkers. You know, ha! I can put them back to 3.
Yeah, nothing
it's
changed.
It's a trap!
Yeah, it was
two turns were wasted by Slitha, basically.
You activated my trap card.
Well, it's not totally wasted. Like, he really wanted to play those Wild Growths. It's just he just didn't get them.
I think he needs some lessons from Tice. I mean, he does end up wrathing the Voidwalker on the left after
getting
them
five
up. What's interesting, though, is I have to wonder, though, how relevant sometimes. These plays can be just to incentivize a certain turn four as opposed to another. I don't know that that's anything he was thinking about, but sometimes, you know, if the Voidwalker is damaged to two, does the opponent want to play Defender instead of, say, another four drop like Voidcaller? You know, it might affect the way your opponent plays.
You'll probably play the Voidcaller still if you get the Demon.
Right, if you get Demon, like let's say you get a Doomguard, you probably would go for Voidcaller.
Like even if you get in Gangbus, whatever, just still play the Voidcaller. But here, a pretty good situation. Direwolf Alpha, you can deal with the 2-3 and you want to deny the Mana Crystal. Go for face of the rest.
That's actually a very threatening board for Sliffa. Without the swipe.
Well,
that's one way to maybe making a comeback, because you need the Dr. Boom.
More than maybe. I think the Dr. Boom, being on 5, gives you a really good force of nature, gives you an Emperor's Orison, it gives you everything afterwards. So if he's going to come back, I think this is the turn to do it.
Most likely, what you have to plan here right now is that if you play the Dr. Boom and your opponent goes all in, so deals damage to your face with everything, then you probably have a good setup for Force of Nature, because you will use the first tree end to set up the Voidwalker on 1 HP, so the bomb can finish that off and then have another trade. If it doesn't kill the Defender Valkyrs, then another bomb has a good trade.
Good trade, yeah. And if he doesn't go all in and makes trades, you're a pretty happy guy. You just have to dodge Power Overwhelming here. That's the one thing you don't want to see is PO on that 3-1 for the trade, because that would be a complete disaster.
I totally agree with that play, and it's really good to see it as well from Slifer, because he is with his back to the wall. This is his last game. If he loses, he loses the match. So a lot of players tend to be super defensive and would slam maybe Druid of the Claw to protect themselves, which doesn't make them.
To be all fair here, I don't think that was another viable play than the Innervate Dr. Boom. It just brings too much value, and there's no reason to keep the Innervate for 10-6 when you can't even put two cards together there. So.
Well, we'll see if the Boom Bots can do a lot of work. We've seen it. Recent memory, there's been a few decisive Boom Bots. Seems to be the case.
I don't like the Void Color. I would rather see the Tap and the and Knife Juggler. Even though you can have a turn 6 Knife Juggler into Implosion, I would still
I could see that. I could see that. Yeah, I kind of like that play. I think his idea is, I don't want to lose my Juggler to anything, and I really want to get the Implosion Knives. Especially having gone, there's a direct spot from Slitha. There are no demons in that hand.
And now he's totally relieved that this actually happened.
Yeah.
It would have been awful if there would be a Mal'Ganis in the hand.
What about that Voidwalker just being buffed up? What do you do?
Any demon, actually, right? Would be good.
Anything, honestly, at this stage.
Oh, wow, he didn't use the bomb. That's interesting.
Wants to keep more minions for Savage War potential.
But the bomb will be traded with the Haunted Creeper.
Actually, the bomb will kill the Juggler.
Yeah, this bomb is killing the Juggler.
I think it's due for a kill and a juggle here.
He's just got it too as well. Well, Juggler survived.
That's not gonna kill it.
It's not completely alive yet.
Yeah, the bomb still has a chance to kill the Juggler.
If
Haunted Creeper actually attacks into it.
You have to attack into it. Like, if you committed to this plan, you have to attack into it.
Right. It's unfortunate you got a low roll on Implosion if you're Riri here. And we saw him earlier with the board card, and he's going all in. All right.
And now look at that. He needs to kill that Dr. Boom. And if he didn't attack into it, there's a chance that nothing will remain on board. And you will have to roll a 4 on the Implosion to kill the Dr. Boom next turn. That's not something you want to rely on.
Well, it's possible, especially because you rolled 2. But I agree, I would probably attack.
That's not how statistic works, man.
I know, right?
One more hit. Oh, all right, he does it, but Force of Nature and Keeper are here to keep that in check if necessary.
What do you have to say about this? Those bombs were so trollish, right?
They've been waiting.
Oh, man.
Second Force of Nature?
For every life coach in the world.
Makes sense, you just want to clear. Do you even, like, heal the last minion? So, like, Force, you clear 3 minions, and then with Dr. Boomy attack into the 1-1.
Sliffa will probably just play the Druid of the Clone Taunt mode and kill one of the imps, just because he saw one Implosion already.
I see what you mean here, because you actually see one Implosion, you don't expect the second one, and then you're pretty much guaranteed to be safe against anything, no matter what.
Yeah, exactly.
Abusive Sergeant here would really help Riri.
Well, there's still the...
Oh, wow.
Well, he has both, but I think you still go for the implosion.
Yeah,
even you if... You didn't see a swipe. You're sure there's no swipe because it would be already played.
Abusive Lothab is so tempting, though, because you set up a lot of damage on board and then tap Doomguard is one turn away from
it. But why not tap, see first what's happening, and then just play Implosion for free damage?
I think I like Lothab more.
And play Abusive Surge.
Because you can't play Lothab if you tap.
Yeah, but that's not your plan. If
it's
you
not,
tap...
You don't want to win next turn?
Oh, come on.
Well, you do win next turn.
I like Abusive and Lothar, because not only you clear...
Lothar's like, no, we want Imps right here, boys. I'm telling you, it's the Imp.
It's so good, like you get 5-5 and 2-1 on board.
Ah, I don't like it.
You're the Grinch who stole Christmas.
You don't like winning?
You don't like weddings? I heard you don't like weddings. I'm like, no, I'm sure he loves them. Yeah, Lothar right now wants to see a play that's a bit more on the aggressive side.
Because this allows Slifer to make a comeback with the Keeper of the Grove next turn, especially if the implosion will low value.
Yeah, I mean, either way, you have to dodge swipe in a spot like this, right? If you're Riri. Now, if Riri taps, he's putting himself in combo range, but he can't afford not to do it.
Whoops, Dr. Boom is kind of late to the party.
It might still be useful.
What if he tapped last turn?
Yeah. He would have actually played it this turn.
He's still in a fine spot if there's no swipe, right?
Yeah, there is no swipe, there's only that Keeper.
But he doesn't have a setup for lethal anyway this way. And he wasn't safe from comboing, from your opponent comboing your, because of the Lothab already being dead, right? So, I don't know.
It's really tough to figure out what the perfect play was in this case. I feel like the Abusive Lothab was the more aggressive route. If there's no taunt, you basically could win immediately. Ancient of Lore is a bit of an issue. Another Abusive.
Well, I guess you need to tap. If you tap, then you have a lethal with Doomguard.
Well, you know there's no combo because you're still alive.
Yeah.
Well, you could get lethal now with PO even. I think you'd be close enough to... Because you get 9 exactly. Power of Whelming or Doomguard are both lethal off the top. Dark Peddler is also a lethal, with Power of Whelming just being in it with Soulfire.
If you tap,
definitely.
There's about like 6 outs in your deck.
A Discovery.
Good,
but you're dead to Force of Nature. But you've seen double Force of Nature, so there's no way. Okay.
So there's only Savage Roar, and Savage Roar adds 6 damage.
And you're not really dead to Force, right?
Well, you can trade.
Force is out.
You can make the trade.
You use double Force already.
To trade, you can't die to it.
Well, that's an awful draw.
But I'm sure you
trade for the Keeper of the Grove and just go face, play Dr. Boom.
You can't, you don't have the mana.
You play Abusive.
Oh yeah, right.
That's why I think she should probably just play Boom and go face with everything and hope he's not dead.
Well, Slitha does have Ancients of Lore if he wants to heal up. So he might go for the Wild Growth draw. But if he does that, he can't play two minions this turn. He's going to have to commit maybe Lothab Hero Power. Depending on whether or not he wants to heal.
I think it's low to shred on next one as hero power.
And no draw.
Then you can set up your opponent at 10, and you trade for the Abusive Sergeant with your Shade of Nextramus.
Yep.
So you have a lot of outs within your deck. 2 swipes, 1 keeper. What else?
This is not a very good card in his hand. Why do people play that thing?
The Rubin Egg?
Yeah, why do people play a 0/2 for 2 mana?
Seems to be good.
I mean,
it's from Nextramus, and everyone knows that every single card from Nextramus was playable.
I would play Stone Skin Gargoyle over the egg.
Don't count your eggs before they hatch. When they hatch, they're actually pretty good.
Wow, he still doesn't have lethal, but he's got 2
There's
claws.
An option.
He has...
Of the claw, he played only 1, right?
Yeah, there's Savage Roars.
Keeper of the Grove finishes. Savage Roar. What else? Wrath Face? No.
That's not useful. Well, you can still draw.
You can draw into something.
The worst case scenario, you go Wrath and the Shade onto Dr. Boom.
You can still survive, right?
Yeah, no matter what.
Yeah.
It could go super wrong, and everything is a blank. It's possible.
1 card away.
Wow.
Oh, man.
And now there's no lethal possibility.
So he needs to go into Dr. Boom.
He needs to double trade into Boom.
But then what is the follow-up? Azure Drake or Emperor?
Probably Emperor to fit the mana.
To fit the mana, probably.
Is it?
And it's
because if you draw Swipe...
Next turn, you can... Yeah.
You can still play Azure Drake next turn.
But you will waste possible double Swipe turn.
So there's 3 damage right now. He's looking for 6 more. The Boombox alone could account for a portion of that. This is another bad draw for Riri. You can see his face right now is hidden under those... Yeah, those fingers are basically saying, what is this and why do I play this game?
Why am I not winning anymore? What is this druid? He's DMing.
Oh my god, it keeps getting worse. But that's a juggle. That's a juggle.
Something.
You silence your own spider.
And you probably have to consider the Starry Sun as a threat as well.
It looks to me like a threat, yeah. I think lethal doesn't exist anymore.
Oh, man.
Silence Egg.
That's the first knife.
All right, well done. Well done, Boombot.
Nice.
Now you killed, there's a chance. Oh my god.
Look at that. The second card will be a swipe. I'm sure of that.
But he literally can't do anything, right?
He has to.
I swear, if the second card is a swipe, I will feel so bad.
Because, so you mean play Azure Drake instead of Taurus?
I think he might just swipe for 1 on everything and hope the Aspirant tanks the damage. Because that means the eggs don't pop, right?
Yeah. Yep.
And it does, and it lives, which is the exact best Savage outcome. Drawer. Now, top, back-to-back, Riri top decks. Nope, that's a good card to have.
Mal'Ganis is pretty decent.
But, you have to play it. There's no...
There's no reason not to play it.
It's and not Big Game contested. Hunter gets top decked by Slith. No, that's not it.
That is
still lethal, though.
Yeah, still lethal, absolutely.
But it's another swipe, by the way.
Are you amused?
I am.
But it's still lethal. He swipes the poor thing.
Yeah, the Mal'Ganis then attacks with 2-1, and then Savagery goes to face.
Yeah. He's triple checking, making sure that the comeback is not a myth. And it looks like we're going to get into the last game again.
That druid is almost like a reverse sweep.
It's possible. That's exactly what happened last match. Druid took the entire lineup of his opponent by basically keep going with the combos.
To be honest, Riri had a really unfortunate draw.
Yeah, about 5 draws back to back that were dead.
Yeah.
About that much. So it was a pretty bad zoo draw.
Now the big question is, can he recover mentally? Because he was really stressed,
He seemed.
The Law of Horsen says that if you didn't draw your, staple cards in the whole game, then you will draw it in your opening hand, right?
So. We'll see. I think if he mulligans that stuff away, then he's going to be for sure stuck with, the 7 drops and the combo.
Well, so now the big question is who gets the ramp cards. And there is an Innervate.
Slitho gets the Aspirant and the Innervate. Lucky for Riri, he's got the Wrath to deal with the Aspirant if it gets coined out. But I wouldn't be surprised to see Innervate Shade here.
Can you just not do it and wait for...
Well, I mean, Dr. Boom changes things, though.
Yeah. So
Dr. Boom really, really changes things. I would actually pass my turn 2 and go turn 2 Aspirant, turn 3 Shade, turn 4 Boom.
I'll think about it as well. Innervating Shade has some merits because it will grow and at some point you will be able to kill Druid of the Claw. Mm-hmm. But then your curve is a bit worse.
Yeah, Riri currently has a weird hand, but it stands to get a lot better the moment he picks up a an Innervate.
Really,
but this Shredder here with the coin on 3.
Whatever happens, he will be able to play the Shredder.
Yeah. Don't need the ramp. Lose the Aspirant, no issue.
And you can actually attack with the Shade here, because your opponent really wants to kill the 2-3.
Yeah, if you kill the 2-3, then you keep the Shade.
Yeah.
So you get an extra 4 damage out. I mean, an extra 3 damage now, and then an extra 4 next turn, so... I think there was a lot of merit to unstealthing it immediately.
Yeah. But I can understand keeping it as well for the future.
All right. The first draw that doesn't care for Slitho.
What are you telling me? There's a Pilot Shredder here.
No, but the Druid of the Claw is not curving on 4.
No. That will be an Innervate.
No.
Second Shredder.
Keeping that shade stealthed all the way through.
Well,
Keeper the Grove Silence, I don't mind here. What's up?
At this point, I think you need to keep the Shadow Next Ram as hidden until It will be 6-6, so you have a 100% chance of killing a Dreadclaw in taunt mode.
Without BGH also ruining you, I guess?
Yes, exactly. And it, especially when you have Dr. Boom in the hand, right?
Yeah.
You don't care about the Big Game Hunter because you know that you will have a Dr. Boom. So if you have a good trade and your opponent is pushed to use the Big Game Hunter turn after that, after you made the trade, that's a good deal.
So that was an interesting swipe because Keeper of the Grove could have silenced the Shredder and set it up like the one health after the trade. And that would have allowed you to get it out of the board with swipe. But because it's spawning a 2-drop, you're likely to be able to use that Keeper to clean up the Shredder. So there's like two ways to play the turn 4 here.
Yeah. And back to Riri, Druid of a Claw possibility.
Yeah, with a Shade up at 4.
Is there any merit to charge into the Shade?
Well, no, I just want to silence that Shade.
Yeah.
That's it. Like, get a 2-2 and a 3-2.
That's probably best.
Please do offer me a trade. I'll take it.
Yeah, right.
Yep. Then probably Slifa won't answer with a Druid of a Claw in charge mode. Just to clean up the Keeper.
And use the Elephants to guide him.
Goodness.
Well, that's a good draw.
Yeah.
I would have... Actually, I think I would just drop the Sylvanas here and deal 5 damage to the face.
And just curve into Boom afterwards and keep the pressure up until Savage Roar gives you a lethal. Yeah, that just sounds very tempting. But look at the amount of pressure he's putting on anyway, right?
Yeah, I think actually keeping the 4-6 is all right as well.
You've seen a swipe, so...
You've seen swipe, you've seen one Keeper, and there was no Druid on the Claw on 5.
I think Slitha is reverse sweeping at this point.
Yeah, yes.
It's looking really likely that he pulls it off.
Dr. Boom into Savage Roar looks pretty sweet. And he is the one having the tempo advantage.
Yeah, he plays Dr. Boom back. And there's no draw from Riri. He has to find it off the top.
So what's the best play here? The best play is...
That was no good play. Everything feels bad, and that's a problem. And you have to make the best out of a bad situation.
So
and I think that's the Druid of the Claw.
Druid of the Claw is a taunt, right?
Yeah. It's really unfortunate because it feels very weak.
Well, it is weak, and it just dies to the Shade and Druid of the Claw, and then he can go face for 3 damage and play Dr. Boom, and it's perfect. And then he has even Lothep.
Yeah, he can lock out any attempt at recovery from his opponent next turn. Now, the question is, what does Riri play here? No, I can't really see a way for him without getting a BGH off the top. Like, he has the option of healing himself with the Ancient of Lore, but that's not really a way to win, unfortunately. But is there even a way to win?
Well, if he goes Keeper Shade, what happens? Like, Keeper killed at 4-2, then with the second Keeper, you kill the 3-2 to limit the number of minions on board, and you play Shade to have something to fight back. Like, if you go for the heals, it doesn't...
You die and you never win, basically. Yeah, yeah. So now you're hoping he just doesn't have the lethal.
And there is lethal with the Savage.
Yeah, more than enough. And so that gets the reverse sweep from 0-2 to 3-2.
Well, congrats to Slifa. That was really well played.
Yeah, he was with his back to the wall and he was able to come back to the Druid, even though Riri had those bad draws with Zoo. But Slifa played really well. Like, he used all the situations that he was given. And he didn't have great draw himself. Like, he was so close to lethal.
Right, he was always a little shy of getting like a perfect response to anything his opponent played. Like, initially, you know, the double attacks into the Voidwalkers, they looked a bit clunky, but they ended up kind of forcing the defensive Argus out, and that really didn't put a massive, you know, high tempo 4-drop for his opponent, and he ended up being able to, after that point, stabilize and counter the Warlock. Yep. So I'm a little surprised at the way this actually planned out, but hey, you know.
Yeah, like we said in the beginning, Riri winning with Paladin was so huge.
And right.
We thought like he has a big advantage coming into the next matchups, but then Druid.
But that was a long match, actually.
That was a long match. I mean, this is the guy that we casted for the international qualifier.
Yeah.
Online. So he ended up going through his first match. He's got other matches in the round, in the group stage. It's not quite over, so he's not guaranteed to move on. But I think
this is why we're kind of not as excited as usual, right? Because it's still the group stage.
We're on the group stage, of course. Yeah. If people start getting knocked out, then that's another story, but for the time being, it's mostly just moving on.
It's just about getting the consistent winners going through and maybe some upsets going on. But there are not the elimination matches yet, so, you know, it will get more nervous during the later parts of the day.
Yeah, but for now, Spain is actually dominating. AK Wonder and Slytha
went through. Well, I went through. I don't know if they're going
through.
They won their first match, at least the ones that we saw on stream. I don't know if they've played any other ones off stream. I haven't caught it. I know we have some matches going on off stream that we're not broadcasting because there's too many matches in the group stage. We've only got so much time. So that's
it's round robin, right? Yeah, there's a lot of matches. So we'll probably just go through the players like during the break so we can update you guys on the results after that.
Yeah, we'll be asking them what the score is to report on everything. We'll be taking a short break. We'll be back afterwards to keep on going with the Insomnia Tristar Championships. Stay tuned, guys. Don't go anywhere.